Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. This lecture is about chapter 6, and the topic of chapter 6 is contract law. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to look at the fundamentals of contract law, try to link it to business, and at the same time look at contract law from a common law, an Islamic and a civil law perspective. That is quite something. Especially if you take into account that we have to start at the very, very basic. This lecture is meant for those of you who have little or no understanding at this moment of contract law. But you may think you have no understanding of contract law, but maybe this very morning or a short while ago or a couple of months ago, you bought a coffee. Buying a coffee is a contract. Somebody offers something, you accept to pay the price, and you get the coffee, and you become the owner of the coffee, meaning that you can do with it what you want. There are other contracts in life, maybe one which you already entered into, are thinking about, or hoping about. That's the marriage contract. Now, in the Netherlands, girls can marry girls, boys can marry boys, and boys can marry girls. That is the result of the Dutch sovereignty. But the global principle of contracts is when you say yes, and that is the same with the business contract as with a marriage contract, you are bound. And to put it very negatively, no way back. Now, because marriage is also a contract, you can include in the marriage contract so-called prenups, prenuptials. Now, this is an example of a famous couple who have included in their marriage contract a lavish reward for the lady, the Kardashian girl, in case Lamar would terminate the marriage. I don't know whether it is already done in the moment. That could well be. I'm not so much aware of what all these influencers are doing at the moment. But the principle I want to illustrate here is that you can put in a contract basically what you want. Now, if we continue and look at the learning objectives, we for the moment must remain rather broadly. We're going to look at contracting and lawyers. We're going to look at the process within a company, the contract management process. Andy said in the very beginning, we'll look from civil law, common law, and Islamic law perspective, which is reflected in the word which you see in the bottom left, contract laws, pluralism, the existence of different types of contract law within different jurisdictions, following from the fact that the world can be split up into three traditions. But first, back to business. Looking at contracts from a business perspective, very generically at the moment, we can identify two contracts which are of utmost importance in business. It's the sales contract, by which you transfer ownership or by which you transfer a particular right. And we have the services contract, by which you contract to render an intangible performance. Now, if we take the generic functions of law, which are used throughout this course, and we apply them on contracts, we can come up with a very simple list of generic functions. Contracts create value. You define what you will get and what you will deliver for the money you will get. The payment of a contract realizes the value of a contract. When the payment is agreed in the contract, the payment made realizes value. Contracts can be enforced, so when the payment is not made or the goods are not delivered, law protects the value which you created by the contract and can enforce the contract by which it provides you a solution for protecting value. In a contract, as we saw with Lamar and the Kardashian girl, you can include clauses, and those clauses, these contractual terms, can be used to manage risks. So contracts, clauses for risk management. One of the type of clauses you can include is a CSR clause, corporate social responsibility, and by doing so you can ensure and communicate to stakeholders that you have at least the intention to have an excellent reputation. And of course, we can add a lot, and for that I refer you to section 6.1.3, which outlines more specifically functions for business-to-business contracts. We return again to business, and we take a concept from business literature, and that's the microenvironment. Why? Because the microenvironment provides us inspiration, a tool to assess what kind of contracts, what type of business contracts we will encounter in the setting of a business, of a company. That leads to a list. And the list is based on elements which you'll find in the microenvironment. In this case, customers, suppliers, business partners, intermediaries, and all kinds of other contracts. So when you look at this, you start realizing how important contracts for business are. And you can read in the book that companies can have contracts ranging from thousands to 20 to 40,000. And that is understandable if you realize how many relations a company can have. And most of these relations in the microenvironment are regulated by contracts. And on top of that, of course, by the law. But that is something for later. Now, with customers, you can have sales and services contracts. That makes you the money for your ultimate goal, profit. You will have suppliers who bring in resources, ranging from commodities, services, to financing by banks. Employees, employment contracts, and when you cooperate with an advertising agency, a market research agency, a web developer, you also do it based on a contract. Then a business may cooperate with all kinds of partners for whatever reason, or it may be formalized in the form of a joint venture or an alliance. You hopefully remember from intellectual property law that these can be licensed. And if you have a startup and you find an angel which wants to invest in your company, that angel will not invest without a contract. Then products have to go through customers. They have to reach customers. You can apply an agent, an agency contract. You can sell to distributors. You can set up a franchising chain. Think about McDonald's. Or you can deliver your goods to a wholesale company. All these require contracts. And then we have the last category, all kinds of contracts which a company may enter into, like sponsorships, grants and donations, and transport contracts, although we could also put them under suppliers. But apart from that, the notion should now be a company is involved in many types of contracts. That's for sure. If that is the case and you want to do your business properly, you need to manage contracts. Now, we'll look into how contracts can be managed by first identifying the steps involved in contracts management. And at the moment, for now, I want to introduce one other thing, because that actually directly links to this multitude of other parties actually, to some extent, involved in your company. And that risk is the so-called third party risk. Increasingly, companies are aware of the fact that reputation is a key factor in consumers' decisions. Reputation, good reputation, of course, contributes to good relationships and contributes ultimately to sales and revenues. This reputation element and the fact that supervisory authorities and governments increasingly scrutinize companies' behavior, plus the fact that the internet and all kinds of other media make it easily possible for the outside world to criticize a company, have led to an increased attention for the so-called third-party risk. Simply said, you do not want to run the risk of negative publicity or prosecution because the parties with which you cooperate misbehave, act illegally or otherwise, act in a way which society considers unacceptable. Now, This is a complete framework for you to look at, for you to consult. It's a PricewaterhouseCoopers framework. But let's move to the left, the letters in blue. This new type of contract risk is, as said, called a third-party risk. What do companies do at the moment to manage this risk? Most companies have checks in place, a formal process, maybe a standard operating procedure, but at least a process to check whether they want to contract a third party, whether the risk they run is limited, or even better, none. Then if they contract, they can use clauses in the contract to impose on the third party a certain behavior, like behaving in a corporate social responsible way, not involving child labor, not affecting human rights. And on top of that, they can include in the contract the right to audit a third party, meaning that the third party gives the right to the company to come into the company, the third party, check its books, checks its processes in order to assess whether the contract clauses which were agreed were followed by the third party. These are all measures presently taken by companies to mitigate or to completely avoid the third party risk. Now we move on and we move on to another learning objective. And that learning objective is that we look specifically into lawyers and managers, and that is what we do through the whole course. We take into account that we study business also from an international perspective. Now, first of all, a bit negative about managers. The attitude of managers in general towards contract is that they are not very interested. They're not very interested in the legal jargon. Many of them do not like to cooperate with lawyers because the attitudes differ and the chemistry is usually not present. So that is a problem in a company, which problem, from a lawyer's perspective, of course, can be further illustrated by looking at how managers and lawyers view each other with respect to contracting. Well, if you go to the managers, then managers find contracts long, difficult to read. They have actually no idea where to find, especially when we talk about voluminous contracts, where to find the information they specifically need. They cannot really assess what the relevance of clauses is. And of course, the general problem is contracts can conclude all kinds of words and phrases which are very difficult to understand because they're constructed complicated in a complicated way, or they contain jargon, legal language, which is ununderstandable for a manager. Why do lawyers have problems? Because lawyers have to cooperate with the managers. The managers are not really interested. And the lawyers face the problem that the managers basically have no clue, very simply said, about what contracting is. So lawyers would like to get input for contracts, but as they don't know what business really is, they will have difficulty in formulating what kind of information they want, and the managers may get irritated by that, not understand it, and not be able to provide the input. Lawyers are also getting a bit frustrated in practice because they notice that the managers have no idea how complicated drafting a contract can be, and that it in general is not, or at least should not be, an off-the-shelf process. And when the managers are not able to provide input on what the typical risks are in a contract, it is left to the lawyer. And the lawyer might not be able to fully assess which type of risks are involved. For example, can the lawyer assess what type of risk the manufacturing process involves. In other words, will deliveries in time be possible when it is agreed upon in the contract? We move on to, again, the principles of the learning outcomes. And here we see something which we're going to discuss now in the left bottom. Contract laws differ. We call it in the very beginning legal pluralism. Well, that is indeed the case. If we take the EMEA, and you know we have these three legal traditions present in this vast territory, and then we take the European Union, and even within the European Union we have four groups. We can identify four groups of contract law systems. We have the common law in Ireland and Cyprus, and we had it in England and Wales, okay, but they left the European Union. We have the traditional civil law countries, which are having a legal system based on law books, France, Germany, Italy, and of course the Netherlands. The Scandinavian countries are civil law countries, but take a bit of a different approach. They do not collect law in books, but consider law as individual acts. And the Scandinavian countries cooperate intensely on the transposition of EU directives. And then we have the newer EU countries who joined last, Eastern European countries, and many of them still have parts of their laws not completely harmonized with the contract laws in other European countries. There might still be some remnants in the law of the former communist days. So that's a complicated reality, even within the European Union, let alone that we move our business to Asia or to Australia or to the Middle East. Of course, you can understand that there the contract law systems will differ from the civil law country from which you are running your business from. Yet, in order to understand contract law, just like with the four P's in marketing, it is always advisable to understand the basics 100%. So we're going to do that for contract law as well by trying to identify global principles of contract law, which means, can we identify parts of contract law which are virtually identical all across the world? To a certain extent, we can. We have four of them. The first principle is party autonomy, meaning you can contract on anything you want, which is fantastic for business, and you can do it in any way you want. Of course, illegal things cannot be contracted about, so the freedom is limited by criminal law or other type of prohibitions. Then, in the world, the consensualism principle means that the basic way to create a contract, we call it formation, is by one party making an offer, another party accepting it, and then we have a contract. The third principle is that contracts are binding. Think back of the marriage, you say yes, there is no way back. Because once you say yes, and of course the other party said yes before you, you have a contract and there's no way back, it is binding. And to whom is it binding? That's the relativity or privity principle. It's binding to the parties to the contract. It is not binding to anybody else. To make this understandable, better understandable, a complete overview. Unfortunately, my face is in the right hand bottom, but I'll tell you what you can find there, and of course complete sets of slides are available. What is the principle? And try to understand this well, because this is the core. From here you can find solutions from here you can think with lawyers. A contract is created by an offer, which is followed by an acceptance. So offer plus acceptance is contract. Offer and acceptance can be made in any form. Think about an auction, 3,000, 4,000, 6,000. Just a simple sentence, which is followed by an acceptance, verbally realizes a contract. You can do it in writing, you can do it by gestures, you can do it by conduct, you can do it verbally. So offer and acceptance are not bound to any form, so a contract can be created very easily. When there is a contract, there are obligations, what the parties agreed upon, and normally the obligations are performed. One delivers the chair which is sold, and the other party pays, because those were the obligations which resulted from the sales contract. However, life is not perfect, so in reality there might be non-performance. If there is non-performance, we need, and that is this book, a dispute resolution method. If you move to this box, it will say there that that dispute resolution method is either in court or out of court, and dispute resolution may come with remedies, the outcome of the dispute resolution process, and those remedies are either defined in the law, then we call them statutory remedies, or parties have made an agreement on it in the contract. In case something goes wrong, one of them will pay the other a compensation of 2,000 euro. So that is the overview. And if we want to summarize it, we go to the white box, and this describes the process. An offer followed by an acceptance results in an agreement. That agreement forces the parties to perform specific, what they agreed upon, obligations. The obligation must be performed, because if the obligation is not performed, the other party has a claim on the performance of the obligation. Performances which are not rendered, so claims which are not materialized, can be enforced in court. In court, we can bring in contractual remedies or request the court, or the court will decide by itself to allow statutory remedies. And examples of those remedies, and now I hope you understand the process, are demanding performance, so the court can force the performance. The court can give compensation as a substitute for the performance, and a court can dissolve a contract, set aside, and if there is no contract, there are no obligations anymore. So this is the system of contracting, and from here we build on further into detail. We're now going to look in more detail in contracts. First of all, what is generally the structure of a contract? Now, a contract has a heading. It might say sales agreement. It starts with the party's details. Company X in Amsterdam, hereafter referred to as Party A. Company I in Belgium or Maastricht, further referred in the contract as Party B. Contracts may contain definitions, what is meant with. The whereas illustrates the background of the contract. Why do the parties want to contract with each other? This may be helpful for a judge or for the parties if there is a dispute about the content of a contract. Now, therefore, introduces what the parties have agreed upon. It's the core of the contract, the obligations they have agreed upon with each other. Then in the final parts, we find a miscellaneous section. That miscellaneous section is used for some specific clauses for international contracts. That's what we will deal with in lecture 8. And then really at the bottom, we see the words in witness whereof, where both parties, when we talk about companies, are represented by their directors, and their directors both sign the contract on a certain date, state their name, put a signature on it, and then we have a contract. A contract may contain all kinds of attachments to which you can refer in the body. It may include appendices for whatever reason, and a lot of companies work with general purchase or sales conditions, and those may also be attached to the contract and referred to in the body of the contract. That's the structure of a contract. Now, the focus for a manager is more specific on the risks of the contract. In order to discuss risks properly with the lawyer, you need some understanding of the typical legal risks which may pop up in a contracting process. First of all, you should realize, but I'm speaking now about civil law, that when parties are negotiating and one of the parties at a certain point in time stops the negotiation process, it may be so that under civil law, the party who stops the process must pay compensation for the cost which the party which is damaged by the breaking off has. Those costs can, for example, be accounting and lawyer's costs when it is a negotiation about the sale of a company. So this so-called liability before the contract is concluded is what we call pre-contractual liability, and that risk exists in civil law systems. Then in the formation phase, the risk could be that an offer is not an offer. It could be that the acceptance is not an acceptance, and it could be that the person who accepts does not have the authority, the capacity to accept. In those cases, you may think that there is a contract, but there might not be a contract. In the performance phase, we also have typical risk. One of the risks is that it is not clear, because we have to use words in contracts, and words generally are not always able to express precisely what the parties have agreed upon. There might be misunderstanding, there might be different interpretations, and if that is the case, the potential interpretation differences, that means that in case it comes to a dispute, there is a risk involved, because in that situation, the court will have to interpret the contract in order to draw conclusions. Performance might not be rendered, so breach of contract, a risk, and we will run into force majeure, that is, that something happens which you could not foresee, which makes it impossible for you to perform the contract. Think about COVID, think about an earthquake, think about a strike. All kinds of circumstances in real life may occur which block performance. Are you then still liable for non-performance, or does the law provide you an escape opportunity in case of force majeure? We'll see that. And then in the last phase of dispute resolution, the question is which method? We said in the overview slide, go to court, not go to court. Out of court is arbitration, or simply discussing it among each other when it is about two companies. And the question is, when there is no performance and you have to rely on dispute resolution, which remedies are available to you? Now, this brings in these elements, but expands on it. And what we do is we try to provide an overview in which we link the contract process with the functions in a company, and from there we identify which functions may run a specific legal risk. Let's simply say that the contacting of potential and existing customers is done by marketing and sales. That leads, from a contract perspective, under civil law, to a pre-contractual liability risk. The contract is in a company setting, usually reviewed, made, approved by legal, and subsequently signed by the director. That is a risk in the formation phase, one of the risks being that the person who signs is not a director, so that could lead to the question, is there a contract? When somebody signs a contract on behalf of a company without having the authority to do so. Then in the performance phase, we have logistics, which transports the goods to customers, and finance and accounting, who send out the invoices and check whether the invoices are paid. So that is the legal dimension of performance, whereby we as managers have to rely on proper performances by logistics, so logistics must be managed, and timely identification by finance and accounting of non-paid for contracts. When customers would complain to us, initially they probably complain to the customer service department. The customer service department will be able, based on the policies which are made, to solve disputes, and if not, they may have to transfer, when it gets too complicated, the complaint to the legal department. So here we have customer service and legal involved in dispute resolution and liability issues. We mentioned the term contract management. Now, contract management is not an easy task because it involves management and it involves contracts. The eternal problem is that generally managers do not fully understand what legal does, and legal usually does not understand fully what managers are doing. So the challenge is to bring the two together into a contract management system. In the process, we can identify the following steps. Contracts must be drafted. Legal can develop templates, which can be used by sales to contact potential customers to make changes in contracts with existing customers. Contracts must be reviewed. How is that process structured? What we just saw is that legal generally does that, but how is legal doing that? Is there a system in place for this review process? Legal will approve the ultimate structure of a contract. How are they assigned the authority to do so? And preferably it is automated so that it costs as little time as possible. A company should have a system for storing and retrieving contracts. Who develops the structure for storing? Who creates a system by which managers, if they want, or if legal, if they want, can retrieve the right contract quickly, because you may have to consult it again for a talk with a customer. Maybe you want to give your sales force access to contracts with customers. A contract, if needed, require updating. Is legal doing that proactively because they understand the business, or do managers need to request legal to do that? Contracts may terminate at a certain point in time. Is there an alert system in place which notifies salespeople, sales managers, maybe the management, that a contract is to expire and that action must be taken? And finally, if you set up a contract management system, you should assess whether it works, or I should say whether it meets your objectives. Now, your objectives you can formulate as key performance indicators. They will come down to effectiveness and efficiency parameters. But proper management always requires, in the end of a process, control on whether the objectives were met. And that is also, of course, the case when you set up a contract management system. Now, if you want to discuss the risk with a manager when you are a lawyer or the other way around, you can use the concept of a risk matrix, which is based on consequences and likelihoods. And you can understand that when the consequences of a risk are critical, and it is possible, likely, or almost certain, that you have to take measures in the contract. The question being, when the risk is so high, so critical, what can we do in the contract to mitigate it, or even to completely reduce it to zero? Now, law offers you tools, and the main tool in the context of contract law are clauses. Simply said, clauses can be considered as legal risk management tools. Now, what kind of clauses, what are the main clauses you'll find in business-to-business contracts? Confidentiality. You want to ensure that your contracting party does not speak about the terms and conditions and the prices, etc., you have agreed with him. Force majeure, but this should be seen from the common law perspective in business-to-business contracts when they are subject to a common law legal system. Everything which constitutes force majeure must be included in the contract in order for the party who wants to rely on it to be able to rely on every possible cause which can prevent him from performing to be relied on. It's a bit of a complicated sentence, but it simply means if we have a common law contract and you want to avoid being held liable for something you cannot foresee, then you should include in the contract every possible cause which could prevent you from performing. If that is all under the heading of force majeure, you can rely on it and avoid having to pay compensation for non-performance. Termination triggers. Put in the contract what circumstances will allow you to terminate the contract. For example, bankruptcy of the other party, or a takeover of the other party. Jurisdiction, that is what we will discuss in Chapter 8, which laws applicable to the country, to the contract, and to which court will we go if it is an international contract. In other words, in which country do we go to court? Then the contracts will contain a choice for the dispute resolution method. Do you choose, as is often the case in business-to-business contracts, to start with an amicable solution, talk with each other, try to solve it. If that is not possible, rely on arbitration, and usually by including an amicable solution with arbitration, companies can completely avoid having to go to court. And then the last one is, of course, damages. There's also a difference between common and civil law, but you can include a limit, a top, on the compensation to be paid. So with that clause, you can limit the compensation risk. Now, from a business perspective, we always have the word efficiency in our mind, and we're always thinking about how we can improve the business. And improving the business is about increasing the effectiveness. How can we improve sales, the sales force? But a typical business perspective is, of course, how can we save costs? Now, if you have the slides of this lecture, I want to advise you, request you to go to this video and listen to a discussion between a CEO, a financial officer, chief financial officer, and a chief procurement officer, and they are discussing what they can improve within the company with respect to contracting, which could save them cost. A highly interesting video, which I recommend to you. A look at. Now we said in the beginning, civil law, common law, Islamic law. First we move to Dutch law, Dutch contract law. We know that formation is the result of offer and acceptance. Now here we have a difference between common law and civil law, that under civil law, the offer need not contain more than the main elements of the contract, which is generally considered as price and product. When that is accepted, there is a contract, apart from the details which are to be discussed later under the civil law system. Contracts can be non-existent, we call that void, or run the risk of being declared non-existent, which we call voidable. We'll see it on the next slide. You can use clauses to shift risks, but we have the reasonableness concept in civil law. When clauses are considered to be unreasonable by a court, the court may decide that the clause is invalid. Damages. Parties can put a potential amount to be paid for damages in the contract. A party can claim it in court, and if that is not the case, the court can also take the initiative to assess the court by applying a certain method or a certain pricing, which is common in a certain industry. Force majeure is supplementary law in Dutch law. The law does not specifically indicate what constitutes force majeure, but if the conclusion is that there is force majeure, the party who is damaged by it, so in other words, who is damaged by the non-performance of the other party, cannot claim compensation for damages. And the prime remedies, statutory remedies, or if the parties included in the contract in a clause are demanding performance, pay, for example, or setting aside, dissolve the contract so that parties both are relieved from the obligations which resulted from the contract. Now, as said, a contract can be non-existent or run the risk of being declared null. We call that to be annulled. Now, when is a contract void or null? When under Dutch law, the will does not match the declaration. So offer and acceptance are legal acts. Legal acts require a will and a statement of the will. So in principle, when there is no will, or when the statement does not reflect the will, the legal act's requirements are not fulfilled. So if there is no offer, there can be no acceptance. So suppose we have a declaration by somebody and that declaration does not match his will because, for example, he is drunk or he is under the influence of pills or he has a mental disturbance. Does that always mean that because the will lacks, there is no offer? In principle, the answer is yes. But there's an escape for the other party, and that is this Article 35 in Book 3, which says if you to whom the offer is made, have no reason to doubt whether the statement of the other party reflects its will, then that other party cannot hold the lack of will against you. In other words, if somebody acts normal makes a statement, and then later on comes to you and say, yeah, I declared something which I did not mean, because, whatever the reason is, he cannot rely on that lack of the will when you are in a position in which you could assume that what he said was reflecting what he wanted. I'm happy that I could explain this, I hope in a bit of an understandable manner, because it's not an easy piece of the law. Then other reasons which result in a contract not coming into existence, being a void, is that when the law sets formal requirements, like it must be in writing, and the formal requirements are met, there is no contract. Also, when the content of the contract violates public order, morality, is against what criminal law prohibits you, or has something in it which is considered unacceptable in society, then the contract also does not exist. For example, you would agree with another student to run around naked for an hour in the university, and you would not do it, then indeed there is no performance, but because the contract, the content, is against what we consider acceptable in society, there simply is no contract. The same would apply to the transportation of cocaine, or other illegal acts. You cannot contract on that, and if you contract on it, there is no contract, because the agreement you made is simply void. In other circumstances, in spite of the fact that something is wrong, there can be a contract, but the contract runs the risk of being voidable, which means that the contract is in existence, but can be declared void. In the case of, for example, a mental disturbance, if not, the other party can invoke the escape of this Article 35 of Book 3. In principle, minors do not have the capacity to enter into contracts. When somebody is under guardianship, the guardian contracts on behalf of the person he is helping. And here we have three which are more relevant in the context of business. When the contract results from fraud, threat, or abuse of circumstances, it is also avoidable, and I'll later on give you an example. Fraudulent conveyance in a bankruptcy setting may lead to transferring property to another party, and by doing so, you may limit the creditor's recourse on the estate, and that conveyance may be declared void, may be annulled, because it is fraudulent. The fundamental mistake is also a legal option, but that's a rather detailed, complicated story, which we will leave for the moment. We'll look into two examples to illustrate void and voidable and this Article 335. First of all, the following. There is a website. The website offers a couch, and the website says, we have a very special hot offer for you. You can buy the couch for €4.95. Simply click here and you can order the couch. Does that result in a sales contract? Two possibilities, yes or no. Maybe is not an answer. But the answer is found in Article 335. You who see the offer can reasonably assume that this is a mistake. If you can see that it is a mistake, you cannot, by acceptance, create a contract. If it would say €495, you could assume that that is the normal price, and then by accepting it, the contract would originate. In this case, the offerer, the company who offers the couch, is not bound by your acceptance. If the price would be 495, but also an error, because the real price is 900, the company would, because it seems like a normal offer, be bound to it. And then another story, which I included because I think you might know Martin Garrix. Martin Garrix entered into a contract, but he later on came to the conclusion that the contract was concluded because the other party supplied him with the wrong information and the other party was operating under two caps. So he went to court and he invoked fraud, and the court came to the conclusion that that was the case. So the court allowed him, granted him, the statutory remedy of contract annulment. So the contract was annulled, which means that everything which was paid has to be returned. So Garrick demanded 3.7 million euro from one company and 650,000 from another company. Well, here you have the production and management contract was annulled. So all rights, all already made payments went back to Martin Garrix. The other parties were left with nothing because there was no contract anymore. Now, I hope there is some beginning among you of understanding contract law, and we'll now flash through a contract law from an English law perspective. English contract law consists of common law, court cases, but the common law countries, and specifically England and Wales, have another legal system, which is the equity law system. And the equity law system allows parties to request a court for an equitable remedy. The system is, if the common law would lead to an outcome which is ultimately unfair or unreasonable, the damaged party may request a remedy based on the law of equity. So the law of equity provides solutions for unreasonable, unacceptable outcomes of the application of common law. Contract is not, under English law, part of the law of obligations, but is considered as a very commercial thing. So concluding a contract under English law has requirements which reflect this commercial character. Under English law, offer and acceptance do not suffice. For a valid contract, it must be clear that the parties had the intention to enter into a commercial agreement, because a contract is a commercial agreement. And the commercial character also reflects in the consideration requirement. A contract must involve something of value which is given up by both parties. So it should involve money, something of value, which each party gives to the other party. That is the consideration requirement. Now, the rules are, because it's common law in case law, but of course, and certainly when the UK was still part of the European Union, there is legislation. The peculiar thing is, but that's a bit of an ethnocentric statement because I look at it from a civil law perspective, is that English law does not recognize the pre-contractual obligation as we know in civil law. The approach under English contract law is, if you want to have something, if you want to rely on something, put it in the contract. So pre-contractual obligations do not exist unless the parties contracted on it. Then, offer and acceptance is considered differently in the sense that the acceptance is only an acceptance of what is in the offer. Civil law says price and goods, price and product, those suffice for an offer. English law takes the point, the viewpoint, the principle of the mirror image. So an acceptance mirrors what is offered. Now you can understand that English contracts are big, because if you make an offer, you must include in the offer every possible detail in order to be sure that the acceptance is an acceptance of every possible detail. you can less rely on supplementary law than you can do under civil law. Then English law has the parole evidence rule, which means that in principle only written evidence is taken into account in the context of contract law, and English business-to-business contracts use clauses, and one of the type of clauses which is typical for common law contracts is the entire agreement clause, by which the parties agree that whatever they discussed or agreed upon prior to the contract or after the contract was concluded, that it is of no relevance for the interpretation of the contract. The contract reflects entirely, completely what the parties have agreed upon. Nothing else can be invoked. And in that sense, it differs from civil law, where a judge will look into what was the intention of parties, and he may derive that intention from what was discussed prior to the contract or after the contract. English contract law requires you to predetermine compensation in the case of a non-performance. That should be stated as an amount in the contract, and we refer to that as liquidated damages. English law does not have supplementary law which gives a party the right to invoke force majeure. No, the principle is, if you as a party want to invoke force majeure, you must put it in the contract what in the setting of this contract qualifies as force majeure. And if COVID is not in the contract, then in principle you cannot rely on COVID to invoke as force majeure as a blockage for a claim for compensation because you could not perform. The commercial contract of English contracts is also reflected in the prime remedy, compensation of damages, because in principle contracts are for commercial purposes, they involve money, and that monetary value is reflected in that consideration requirements. Now we're going to test our ethnocentric mind again. We may have been a bit impressed by the differences between common and civil law, and of course the two systems also differ from contracting under Islamic law. Let's talk about Islamic law and contracts. We'll find the rules in the Sharia, which is the Islamic law system, which is a mix of religion and legal rules. Initially, at first instance, not easy to understand if you are from a different legal tradition, but do keep in mind that many Islamic countries also have civil law books, partially because they had historical ties with France or for other reasons adopted a civil law approach specifically for business issues. Now, the interpretation that is slightly different from common and civil law in the sense that legal scholars can interpret the Quran and other sources of Islamic law and provide statements on how a certain element of a contract or a rule should be interpreted. If an Islamic country has separated, let's say, the traditional use of Sharia from the use of Islamic law in business, you will simply have courts which can interpret contract, but they will always do so from the perspective of Islamic law. Now, offer and acceptance also constitute the basic principles for contracting. There is a bit of an old rule in Islamic law that as long as the parties are in the same room, they can change their position. So even when one party has accepted and they are still in the same room, he may return to his acceptance and withdraw it and restart negotiations. But because nowadays people are in different places, That rule is interpreted very broadly and gradually fades away a bit in a business context. Now, promises must be met. Civil law and common law take a simple approach. Civil law says, yeah, that's in the law. Common law said, yeah, that's in the contract. And under Islamic law, you meet a contractual obligation because religion forces you to do so. Contracts are binding because religion tells you that when you agree on something with somebody else, you must simply do that. Under Islam, you have certain prohibitions. I first go to the prohibitions here below. Charging and paying interest is prohibited. Gambling or contracts which contain an element of uncertainty are prohibited. And contracts on certain products like alcohol and pornography are also prohibited. When you have a contract which violates Islamic prohibitions, like it includes an interest to be paid in case of late payment, then the contract, or at least that specific clause, is non-existent. It is considered void and it is unenforceable in Islamic courts. The uncertainty prohibition leads to the conclusion that if you sell products which do not yet exist, that is conflicting with the uncertainty prohibition, so such contracts are void. On the other hand, you are allowed to include clauses to manage risk. So liquidated damages and penalty clauses are considered acceptable, but there's a general rule under Islam that you should never abuse another human being. So when the liquidated damages or penalty clauses are so unreasonable or so high that they become abuse of the other party's weakness, they are invalid. You may limit your liability, but also keeping into account that you should never abuse another human being. Now, force majeure also exists, the concept under Islamic law. It is called misfortune from heaven. And the simple approach is, if something bad happens to another human being, you should never profit from it. So in that sense, it is comparable to what force majeure is under common law and civil law. The prime remedies are performance or rescission. Why is compensation not primarily thought about? Because compensation has an element of abuse. So if you can have it solved, the dispute, by having the other party to perform as agreed, or by relieving the both of you from the contractual obligations, that is considered to be a fair approach to a non-performance relating from contractual obligations. So you see, we did put some emphasis on the remedies, because if business runs normal, there is no problem. But if there is non-performance, you have a problem. And that problem leads to the question, what can I do? And the question, what can I do, is basically the question, what remedies are available to me? So we have discussed it, and have a look at this slide, because this slide gives you a hierarchy, an order of remedies, which is the generally accepted order of remedies in the three major legal traditions. We move on to a more business context. And in this business approach we take in this course, we very frequently rely to the division between internal and external. And basically, we are constantly looking at areas of law, and we try to see what the relevance is for running the business, management, specifically of the legal department. and what the relevance is from a strategic management perspective, what is happening in the outside world that I should take into account in my strategic management process as an opportunity or threat. Now, when we look at this internal dimension from the perspective of contract law, we become interested in how have we structured contract management within the company, and if we have done so, how well is the legal department performing? And on the external side, we are of course interested in developments in contract law, new rules or new case law which may have relevance for us. Think, for example, now at the moment we have COVID. What does COVID mean for our contracting? Should we include it in the contract? Can we rely on force majeure by invoking that COVID prevents us from performing? So, under Dutch law, we cannot be held liable for compensation. So, externally, we are interested in developments in contract law and enforcement. Now, we know that all kinds of firms and institutions make reports available. Those reports can help us in identifying developments in the external regulatory environment. And one of those reports is by the World Bank, the Doing Business reports, which are updated annually. An element of the report is enforcing contracts. We will look at that and compare the Netherlands and Poland. The clock represents effectiveness. How long does it take us to start a court case and end up with a decision? And the euro represents cost. If we go to the World Bank report, then overall the Netherlands scores slightly less than Poland. But if we go to enforcing contracts, the Netherlands scores slightly better than Poland. But there is a typical difference. If we look at the time it costs to start and end a court case, we see that in the Netherlands it is rather slow, and in Poland it is, in comparison, rather quick. We see also that in the Netherlands, as a percentage of the claim value, the Netherlands is more expensive, 23%. Poland, it will cost you 90% of the claim. But overall, the judicial process is considered better than in the Netherlands than the judicial process of Poland. Now, suppose now you would enter into a contract with a Polish company. Then the debate is probably, shall we make Polish law applicable to the contract or Dutch law? Shall we go to court in Poland or shall we go to court in the Netherlands? Overall, you can simply say if there is a dispute and you would go to court, then the court case is finished much quicker in Poland. You get your money much quicker than it would be in case we would run the case in the Netherlands. The rest of the differences are not so enormous. So from here, we could come to the conclusion that going to court in Poland, if necessary, is probably a better choice than going to court in the Netherlands. Now, the internal dimension is about how do we assess to what extent we have a proper contract management system. It's a bit of an internal audit of the legal department from the perspective of contract management. Now, the performance indicators we could look at is how long does it take, the contract cycle length, how well is the quality of the contracts, is it consistent or do we get different contracts all the time, which makes it for us managers rather difficult, is the performance in time, is it quickly, and is it cost effective? in the sense that the legal department does a lot of work by itself and does not constantly have to rely on the very costly external legal services providers like law firms. Now, if you want to get an idea about how it operates with respect to contract management within a company, have a look at this article by Dennis Pontemkin, which nicely illustrates how the contract management process in a typical company is, but he also advises you, gives recommendations on how you can improve the contracting process within a company. Now, to finalize the checklist, you are a manager, you get a contract in front of you, and the question of the legal department is, can we agree? Legal department finds it okay, but of course you realize that you as business manager or CEO have the ultimate responsibility when something goes wrong. So this is a checklist of points you can run through. Because you have this ultimate responsibility, you cannot simply fully rely on the legal department. I think for 90% you can. But have a look at this and realize yourself by reviewing the point, what comes on your desk and what you have to put a signature below. And you know that when you put a signature, that your company is bound. And you know that when you bind the company, that you may, under certain circumstances, be held liable for what you do. Well, that is a topic which will be discussed in the next lecture, which will deal with legal persons and corporate law. And for the moment, we limit ourselves to contract law. I hope you come to the conclusion that we meet the learning objectives. We discuss contracting, we discuss lawyers and managers, we discuss contract management. We looked into the differences between the various contract laws systems in the legal traditions, and we gave it an international perspective by reviewing it from an international business setting. So if you really understand it, you can answer these self-assessment questions. And if you are a bit bored and you want to look into something nice, have a look at crazy football contracts, crazy sale-up contracts, marriage contracts, and weird real estate clauses. This concludes the setting for today. This was about contract law, chapter 6. I hope by reviewing and reading and listening, you start understanding it, and maybe a little hope you start finding it interesting. At least I hope that your conclusion is contracting is extremely relevant for business. Thank you very much. This was it for today.